Well, good morning. It's good to see those that are here this morning. We will go ahead and get started with our call to worship. So if you'll please stand, we will sing the first and last of number 547, I Stand Amazed in the Presence, 547.
In the presence of Jesus the Nazarene, and wonder how he could love me, a sinner condemned, unclean. How marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. How marvelous, love for me. When with the ransomed in glory his face I at last shall see, 'twill be my joy through the ages to sing of his love for me. Oh, marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. How marvelous, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me.
And you may be seated.
Good morning, Hillcrest Baptist Church. It's good to see everyone here this morning. I hope you all are doing well and enjoying this fall weather. I have a few announcements for you this morning. First of all, in the back of your bulletin, you'll see that the annual Ladies Christmas brunch is coming up. They will have a Stingy Santa. Limit is $15. If you have not signed up, ladies, there is a sign-up on the Hillcrest Happenings table. Please make sure to go and sign up and enjoy a morning full of excitement and fun. Other activities going on. Of course, you know, on Sunday evenings, we have ACT Teens at 5 o'clock, and then our normal service at 6 o'clock, and we ask that you can come and enjoy an evening of singing and a message from Brother Jerry tonight, if you can make it. And then on Wednesdays, we have prayer service, and we have the youth going on, and we have mission friends, and GAs and RAs, and just all kinds of activities going on Wednesdays. And we ask, come back on Wednesday and bring your children. There's activities all evening for them, so we ask that you come if you can. But it is good to be in the house of God this morning, and we want to welcome everyone here. We want to welcome our guests. If you're visiting here for the first or second time, thank you for choosing to come to Hillcrest. If you're a regular, we're glad you're here as well. We want to stand up and we want to welcome each other, and we're going to wave as we sing.
So glad I'm a part of the family of God. I've been washed in the fountain, cleansed by his blood. Joined us with Jesus as we travel this sod. For a part of the family of God.
And you may be seated. And we will continue on with number 544, Redeemed, How I Love to Proclaim It, 544.
Redeemed, redeemed by the blood of the Lamb, redeemed through His infinite mercy, His child and forever I am. Redeemed, redeemed, redeemed by the blood of the Lamb, redeemed, redeemed, His child and forever I am. Redeemed and so happy in Jesus, no language my rapture can tell. I know that the light of His presence with me doth continually dwell. Redeemed, redeemed, redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Redeemed, redeemed, His child and forever I am. I think of my blessed Redeemer, I think of Him all the day long. I sing, for I cannot be silent, His love is the theme of my song. Redeemed, redeemed, redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Redeemed, redeemed, His child and forever I am. I know I shall see in His beauty the King in whose law I delight, who lovingly guardeth my footsteps and giveth me songs in the night. Redeemed, redeemed, redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Redeemed, redeemed, His child and forever I am.
And if you would please stand, we'll continue on with number 514, When We All Get to Heaven, 514.
Sing His mercy and His grace in the mansions bright and blessed. He'll prepare for us a place when we all get to heaven. What a day of rejoicing that will be when we all see Jesus. We'll sing and shout the victory. While we walk the pilgrim pathway, clouds will overspread the sky. But when traveling days are over, not a shadow, not a sign. When we all get to heaven, what a day rejoicing that will be when we all see Jesus. We'll sing and shout the victory. Let us then be true and faithful, trusting, serving every day. Just one glimpse of Him in glory will the toils of life repay. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory. Onward to the prize before us, soon His beauty we'll behold. Soon the pearly gates will open, we shall tread the streets of gold. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory.
And you may be seated.
Every time I try to make it on my own, every time I try, Jesus.
Shall we pray? Almighty God, we thank you for this day. Our hearts being tuned into you, even more so now as your word is proclaimed. Thank you for this place where we can come and worship. Break the hearts of each and every one that's here today as we listen to your word proclaimed. We praise you, God, and we lift up the offerings that are brought here today, that you be pleased with them and used for the furtherance of your kingdom. We love you and praise you in Christ's holy name. Amen.
That God's part of my quiet time this morning, and I'm going to be talking about trusting in God this morning, and that's been on my heart for some time, that there's so much stuff going on within our world, our country, our church, that we really need to understand who God is and to be able to trust Him. So in Proverbs chapter 8, Solomon was talking about wisdom. So let me read to you just a few verses that he said about wisdom, but it turns into the Lord as creator. The Lord possessed me at the beginning of his way. He possessed wisdom, the thing that he passes on to us. Before his works of old, I have been established from everlasting, from the beginning, before there was ever an earth. Can you imagine Solomon speaking about things that took place before he was ever born, the creation of this earth? When there were no depths, I was brought forth. He's still talking about wisdom this whole time. When there were no fountains abounding with water, before the mountains were settled, before the hills, I was brought forth. While as yet he had not made the earth or the fields or the primal dust of the word. When he prepared the heavens, I was there. When he drew a circle on the face of the deep, when he established the clouds above, when he strengthened the fountains of the deep, when he assigned to the sea its limit, so that the waters not transgress his command, when he marked out the foundations of the earth. Can you hear God creating the world? Then I was beside him as a master craftsman, and I was daily his delight, rejoicing always with him, rejoicing in his inhabited world. And my delight was the sons of men. I read that this morning, and I wanted to share it with you because that just explains to us that without God, we have nothing. God is able. He's able to do anything he wants to do. He's willing to do things that you and I cannot do. So we're going to look at Psalm 20 today. And let me read it to you, and I've got some thoughts that I'd like to share with you. Psalm 20, we're going to look at all 9 verses. David writes, "May the Lord answer you in the day of trouble. May the name of the God of Jacob defend you. May he send you help from the sanctuary and strengthen you out of Zion. May he remember all your offerings and accept your burnt sacrifice. Selah, be still. May he grant you according to your heart's desire and fulfill all your purpose. We will rejoice in your salvation, and in the name of our God we will set up our banners. May the Lord fulfill all your petitions. Now I know that the Lord saves his anointed. He will answer him from his holy heaven while saving strength of his right hand. Some trust in chariots, some in horses, but we will remember the name of the Lord our God. They have bowed down and fallen, but we have risen and stand upright. Save, Lord, may the King answer us when we call." Man, what good verses to know in our hearts. I don't know about you, but I love the book of Psalms. I thought about how often I preach out of them, how often I use them in my personal life, and I think I could preach the rest of my life in just the book of Psalms. I love it that much. And the reason I think I could preach the rest of my life is because I absolutely know that whatever you go through in life, whatever circumstances we face in life, there's application in the Psalms to fit every single problem that we go through in life. So if we study Psalms and we're going through something, then we're going to find an answer. It's up here and it's right here. So I get the title of this message is Save Lord, the Battle is His. And I get this message out of the three verses, verse 9. Verse 9 says, Save Lord. So if you were coming up with a message title, that's a pretty good title right there. But then look at 6 and 7. Now I know that the Lord saves His anointed. He will answer him from His holy heaven with the saving strength of His right hand. The battle is God's. I want everybody to hear that today. The battle is God's. I read a whole lot of books, and I get a lot of my introductory statements from books, and I have one now. I'm not sure where I got it from. I know I read it, and I think I know who it's from, but I'm not going to quote him because I may be wrong, but I'm pretty sure it's Charles Stanley. He writes, or somebody, one of my favorites writes, is there a battle before you today? One that seems impossible to win? Then fight it on your knees in submission to the one who can triumph in it for you. Don't depend on your own weapons, strategies, or resources. You already know your abilities in this situation, and they're insufficient. Rather, allow him to be your commander-in-chief in order to achieve the victory he has for you. You must surrender yourself to him fully. What does this mean for you? God may call you to let go of some of your goals in order to accomplish the plans he has for you. Likewise, you may need to step out in faith when it's uncomfortable or even frightening to do so. But no matter how challenging his commands may seem, obey him anyway. Trust his direction. He is a skilled and mighty warrior who has never lost a battle. He will never let you down. Whoever wrote that, they hit the nail on the head. And then at the end of this devotion, he prays, Jesus, I trust you as my commander-in-chief. Lead me to victory. Amen. I hope that we could agree with this devotion. In your own life, when you're facing any kind of a battle, realize that if you're a child of God and you trust in God, your battle belongs to God. He will fight that battle for you. Amen. Amen.
All right. Amen.
All right. Amen. Now, here's the deal. If you trust in God, and all of us are going to go through a battle or battles, and they're going to be pretty powerful battles, pretty hard battles, things that you and I are not going to be able to win. So if we trust God, remember, it's His battle. When you put your trust in God, it's up to Him to bring you through, and He's never lost a battle yet. So here's some things that we cannot do. You do not depend on your own weapons. You do not depend on your own strategies. You do not depend on your own abilities. You do surrender your life and your trouble to the Lord Jesus.
Amen.
He may ask you to let go of your goals in order to accomplish His plans for your life. Have you ever been there before? If you've got goals and you've set these goals and you're shooting for these goals and you've been doing it all your life, and then all of a sudden God says, that's not what I want you to do. If you want to win the battle, you better put aside your goals and say, Lord, I am willing to do what your plans are for my life. He may ask you to step out on faith and accomplish His purposes even though you can't see what He's asking you to do.
Amen.
If you've ever been there, then you know it's pretty tough. And sometimes it's downright scary to step out on faith. Our church is challenged right now to step out on faith. We've begun the process, but as we watch the Family Life Center being built, we're halfway there. And it may cost more money than we can imagine. We have no idea how much it's going to cost, but we step out on faith because it's God's building. God expects us to hear His direction and follow His direction only. He expects us to hear and to do what He wants us to do. And remember, He has never lost a battle. So before going into a battle, Psalm 20 was written by David. And it could have been written by David as he prayed for the people, for the congregation. But most likely it was the congregation praying for David as he was going into battle. It could have just as well been the high priest praying for all of them as they go into battle. But what it was a prayer of trusting in God's direction and His protection. And that's the whole psalm. Lord, we call out to You, save us. We trust in You. So we're going to look at this verse by verse and look at our own problems. Look at the things that we're going through. And David is going to write things that are so simple to grasp. They're written for us today. So let's start out in let's read verses 1 through 4 again, but we're going to start out with verse 1. So verses 1 through 4 kind of tie in together. May the Lord answer you in the day of trouble. May the name of the God of Jacob defend you. May He send you help from the sanctuary and strengthen you out of Zion. May He remember all your offerings and accept your burnt sacrifice. May He grant you according to your heart's desire and fulfill all your purposes. So, verse 1, there are two thoughts to deal with. First of all, who do you or what do you depend on, turn to, when you face a great trouble in your life? If you're praying for help, I'm assuming that you already know that you're in trouble. And what a great time to go to the Lord and turn to the Lord when you're in trouble, because there's nobody else going to be able to help you anyways. You know that God is going to take care of you up here. That's what we're taught in Sunday school. That's what we preach. God's going to take care, and it sinks in really good up here. But then when we get about halfway through the trouble, what about in your heart? Do you truly trust that God's going to take care of everything? Can you just hand it to God and say, "This is your battle, Lord. And I'm not going to worry about it anymore." The word trouble here means adversity. And David knows in his heart that he needs God's help in his time of adversity. So we come to the second thought in verse 1. He asked the Lord to defend the people, or the people asked the Lord to defend David. Someone prays that the Lord will defend someone else. The main point is that we rely on God's protection as we go through these troubles, as we face anything. And boy, this past week or two or three, Rhonda just whispered to me before I got up here, 3 or 4 different prayer concerns. Jesse's in the hospital in Korea. That's a pretty major thing. He's been in the Army. He's coming home January 20th, supposedly. Now he's got to go to Korea. Misty had surgery this week. I mean, it's just been one thing after another. And we know that God's going to take care of it, but what about in our heart? I can tell you right now, God's going to take care of Jesse. I know it. I already saw that He took care of you. I didn't expect you to be back for 6 weeks. Aren't you glad it's not me taking care of your problems? Up here or in here? up here, we know it, but my question to you is, if you get halfway through, do you try to fix it? And if you try to fix it, then you really don't have a heart knowledge of God. Am I talking to somebody today? Am I talking to people that try to fix things when they give it to God? And that's what God hears. That's what he sees when you say, Lord, here it is. I give it to you. And at first, it's so easy to give it to God. And then all of a sudden, it's not going the way you want it to go. And now you start fixing it. You start meddling in God's business. God has never lost a battle. And you hand it to him. Here it is, Lord. You take it. And then when you try to take it back, tell me where the heart knowledge is in that. It's not. Your preacher loves you enough to tell you it's not. The trust in God is, here it is, God, and then walk away from it. And God sometimes gives us direction of what we ought to do to take care of it, and then we obey what he says do. But if he doesn't give us direction and say, my son, I'll take care of it, you best let God take care of it. The word defend means to make lofty or inaccessible. Adversity usually comes from Satan. You know, John 10:10 says the thief comes to steal, to kill, to lie, to destroy. And we know that the thief is Satan. So when we go through troubles, adversities down here on earth, it's usually from Satan. And when David prays, defend us, he's saying, lift us up lofty way. Make us inaccessible to Satan. So when we trust God to take care of it, he defends us. And when he defends us, he lifts us up above what Satan can bother us with. He cannot bother us when God makes us inaccessible to Satan. Does that make sense? Did that come out right? Oh, it's so important that we trust God. We got a whole psalm, 9 verses, telling us to trust God and to realize that when we trust him, Satan has no control over us. It becomes God's battle. It is his battle. He will finish his battle. Now look at verse 2. May he send you help from the sanctuary and strengthen you out of Zion. We ask God not only for help, but for strength. David prays that God would strengthen him out of Zion, and he mentions Zion and sanctuary in the same verse. The sanctuary is God's presence. Zion is a place of holiness. So we ask for God's strength, we ask for his strength, and we ask for his presence. Amen. Lord, surround us. When we turn it over to the Lord and trust him, he somehow or another puts his arms around us and surrounds us with his ability, his willingness to take on Satan and all the adversities that we face. We find strength in God's holiness. We find strength in the presence of God in our lives. We trust him and ask him to seek us as he lifts us up and makes us inaccessible to Satan's attacks. And then look at verse 3. And remember, he may remember all your offerings and accept your burnt sacrifices. We don't work for salvation, so don't hear this verse wrong. But we do commit our lives to the Lord. We surrender our lives to Jesus. And we don't live our life just so God will reward us. But when we're facing troubles, we go to the Lord and say, remember, Lord, I've been as faithful and committed as I can. Now take over. It's pretty important in God's eyes for us to make sacrifices to him, to pick up our cross, to deny ourselves, pick up our cross, and carry it daily. And trust in him when times come that we can't handle. He remembers our sacrifices. He remembers our commitments. If you do verses 1 through 3, then you ask verse 4. May he grant you according to your heart's desire and fulfill at your purpose, all your purpose. At this point, you turn your trouble over to the Lord. Your heart's desire is to have victory. God, now hear this. If you don't hear anything else, hear this. God knows whether you trust him or not. And because you trust him and hand him whatever you're going through, and you've prayed for his strength and his presence, and in your head and heart you trust him and you give it to him and you just back away, verse 4, you get that peace that passes all understanding. How do you explain that when you can't even see it? You don't. You just know it's, you get the peace. Anytime I make a major decision, I know I have my answer when I have peace about it. Sometimes it takes days, sometimes it takes years to pray through something and get that peace that passes all understanding. But I go through this whole process, and if I don't have that peace, I continually check to see if I'm actually trusting God with the problem or not. So let me ask you, and I wish I could ask each of you privately, individually, verse 6. Now I know that the Lord saves his anointed. Do you know that God saves you from trouble? He rewards you with victory over the trials, the things that we go through. And I ask each one, if I could, I'd go around and ask each one of you that question. We've, as a church, have gone through the last 2 years, but this country has been going downhill for years, and some of us are scared to death. Do we know without a doubt that God controls everything? That's the reason I read Proverbs. He's the creator of this all, everything. Elections, politics, bank accounts. I mean, there's nothing outside of God's will and outside of his ability to take care of it. And sometimes God lets things happen that we don't like. But it falls under Romans 8:28. God works out all things for good that those who love him and serve him according to his will. And he created this earth way before anybody ever was here or even thought about it. So he's able to do all things. And one day he's going to take us all away and rise us up. So he knows whether we trust him or not. And then verse 6, do you totally believe it? Do you believe that you can trust God with everything? And some of you are already shaking your head, yes, I do. But the deal is, if you hand it to the Lord Jesus, here it is, Lord, and if you don't back away, if you take it from him, you saying yes, but if you do that, then the truth of the matter is, no, you do not trust him. This is a huge lesson for every Christian. We need to learn how to trust God. Because these things that we're going through now may be just a piece of cake compared to what we're going through later on. It could get downright rough. David follows up the question, do you know that God takes care of you, and do you trust him in verses 7 and 8? So look at those. Again, David's writing this to his people, but it's to us, and it's from God to David to us. Some trust in chariots, some in horses, but we will remember the name of the Lord our God. Which do you choose? We don't have chariots anymore. Well, we have different things just as they had chariots. They bowed down, those that trusted in chariots, and fell. Verse 7, we'll remember the name of the Lord. And then verse 8, we've risen up and stand upright. You read those two verses together. There's two things going on here. You either trust God or you're not. If you trust God, you'll stand up through it all. You'll arise over the problem. If you don't trust God, then you're liable to fall. Do you trust God with your own weapons, with your abilities, with your things, your assets, or do you trust the Lord? If you trust God, no matter what happens, you're able to stand. If you don't trust God, then you fall down. And then close with verse 9. Save, Lord, exclamation point. Save us, Lord. Save us. This ought to be our prayer for every Christian. We ought to be praying for one another. Save us, Lord, because we're facing a lot of decisions that are not going to fall our way. The laws of this country are changing. They're not Christian laws. They're not godly laws. Things are happening. Save us, Lord. We're going to be faced with making decisions based on worldly problems. But we're Christians, so we're going to have to take a stand with God. Save us, Lord. Help us to stand. We may have to make decisions that are not going to benefit us at all. But God sees and He knows in our heart. And we've already got the victory if we do it God's way. The Israelites prayed for David, Lord, save our king. Hear us, Lord, when we call. Kind of tying all these thoughts together. Trials and adversities have a purpose. God allows them. Number one, they draw us closer to God, and they help us to develop our trust in God. The older we get, especially, we realize, we were talking about medicine this morning. Medicine doesn't always take care of us. God takes care of us. Now, we depend on medicine. If the doctor tells you to take medicine, you best take that medicine. But you pray and trust God. And if the medicine doesn't work, and it's a deathly diagnosis, save, Lord. And the good thing about it, He will save us and take us to eternity with Him. Is that not victory? Yes, sir. Thank you, Lord, for that. But throughout our life, we trust God. We go through stuff, and that develops our trust even more in God. Number two, these trials prepare us for something else coming. You don't just get one trial in your life. You get multiple trials. Some of us just live in a big trial. God's got a purpose. We trust Him. Number three, they help us determine what choice we'll make in another time of trouble. So maybe you don't trust God completely in the first two or three or four or 14 or 24 trials. But throughout all those trials, we're learning to develop a trust in God. And sooner or later, we're going to get down to the end of the line down here after multiple trials and adversities. So here it is, Lord, I've learned my lesson. I can't do it. And then we'll just step back and allow God. And, you know, you can almost do like this and watch God work. And, man, you can see Him fell trees down right in front of you. Hillcrest Baptist is faced with opportunities to trust God. He will cause us to have to step out on faith. Is that easy? Shake your head yes or no, because I'm going to say it's not easy at all. It's just what we do when we learn to trust God. We step out and have faith in Him. But here's the deal. Here's the final point. God knows the outcome and we don't. That's a big amen.
Amen.
Aren't you glad that you don't have to deal with the outcome? God's already got it figured out. A couple weeks ago when we did the trunk or treat, it was raining, cold raining. And we started praying, God, we need to have this. And He stopped the rain except for just a mist. And then that mist was gone. And we had a very successful trunk or treat. God handles these things. That's a simple little thing. But if He can handle the simple, He handles the big things too. So I look around and I know that we've faced some pretty big things. And you're still here today. God can handle them. He can take care of them. And when He takes care of them, you'll get that peace that only God can give you. And what a wonderful peace it is. Well, I'm through. I feel good now. I could just walk out that door and be satisfied. I shared with you one of my personal devotions. And how I spoke to you today is exactly how I spoke to God. And God gives the feeling, the peace. Aren't you grateful for His peace? We need it. We sure do. I hope that you know Jesus as your Lord and Savior. You got to start there. I heard a sermon that when we get saved, it's not just believing in Jesus, but it involves repentance as well. We believe that God died on the cross. But at the same time, we turn away from our sins because God makes us a new creation. He gives us a new heart. So when we get saved, God gives us that new heart. That means we don't continue to live in the sin that we did beforehand. Not that we won't slip back sometimes, but we don't dwell in the sin. So I want you to make sure, without a doubt, that you believe that Jesus died for your sins, but at the same time, you repented of those sins. And you know, all of us are sinners. I know that. We continue to sin. We deal with the old man and the new man. But the thing is, when you're saved, really saved, and you sin, it bothers you. You just hate it. You have the mind of Christ, and Jesus never sinned. So we deal with that. So today, I ask that you would make sure that you're saved, and that as you were saved, you repented of the sin that we were born with. And then others, you're going to face adversities if you haven't already. Learn how to trust in God. And if you can't, if you're a fixer, you give it to God and then you take it back, you try to fix it. Today would be a good day to say, Lord, I need help. I need help to learn how to trust You. Will He do it right away? Probably not. But there'll be trials to come to let you learn how to develop trust in God. So we're going to stand, and if God puts anything on your heart that you need to pray about, I'll be up here. The altar's open. You can pray in your pew, but let's let God have His way with us.
tender voice like thine can peace afford. I need thee, I need thee, every hour I need thee. Oh, bless me now, my Savior, I come to thee. I need thee every hour, stay thou nearby. Temptations lose their power when thou art nigh. I need thee, oh, I need thee, every hour I need thee. Oh, bless me now, my Savior, I come to thee. I need every hour in joy or pain. Come quickly and abide, or life is vain. I need thee, oh, I need thee, every hour I need thee. Oh, bless me now, my Savior, I come to thee. I need thee every hour, teach me thy will. Thy promises so rich in me fulfill. I need thee, oh, I need thee, every hour I need thee. Oh, bless me now, my Savior, I come to
This is Audrey Sutton, and she wants to join our church.
Amen.
She was part of New Providence Baptist Church, and she's been coming here for over a year, I guess, pretty long time. She's been going to Sunday school faithfully, and now she wants to join church. Isn't that great? Yeah, amen. We've been praying for her for however long she's been coming. We've been praying, Lord, draw her here, and we did, so... you would, amen, praise the Lord as you accept
amen.
Her.
Amen.
All right. We're going to be careful, come welcome her, but don't do the right thing. You know what I'm saying? The social distancing stuff. So just take care. Father, Lord, thank you for Audrey's decision. Thank you, Father, that we have a church that people want to join because we worship you. We love you and praise you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you.
Thank you.